Normal words, but a horse guy.
So you watch BoJack Horseman's final season and you're like, I don't like how they use the season's fuck, okay? It's a very underwhelming last fuck. Okay, so for the no spoiler section of this review, I will say that the final season was great, but it is very clearly two seasons that got merged into one. The additional four episodes helped with the pacing a lot, and there were still some really great standout episodes, but a Princess Carolyn episode now has to become a Mr. Peanut Butter episode for like 5 minutes and then go back to being a Princess Carolyn episode. It's not even like a side plot. The episode you're watching just kind of stops for 5 minutes. I mean, they try to blend the two stories together, and it's still enjoyable and well done under the circumstances, but you can tell they had more than 16 episodes worth of story left. It's unfair to the writers of the show because they had to end all these characters with less time than they originally planned, but I think overall they pulled it off pretty well. You can be mad at Netflix all you want, but 6 seasons is a good lifespan for a show, and they did not get nearly as screwed as a show like Moral Oral did, or hell, Tuca and Birdie for that matter, though I guess that would be a reason to be mad at Netflix. Maybe Netflix is changing, but my favorite show of all time would not exist without them, so for that, I thank you. Still, dick move of Tuca and Birdie. That show didn't even really get much of a chance at all. I don't love it like I love BoJack, but it was funny, and I did actually see people talking about it, so it wasn't like it was unheard of. Getting back on topic, let's dive into spoilers. There were episodes that stood out on their own well, and episodes where all five of the main characters had to share, and as a result, they don't all stand out quite as well, like the episode where Todd reconnects with his stepdad. This could have been a really nice standalone episode for the character that I feel had the most rushed conclusion of the show, but because of the short amount of time, they also had to make an episode about BoJack having a hard time leaving rehab, Princess Carolyn working with Turtle Top during a strike. Kind of a lot going on for one episode, huh? Maybe if we would have had an episode focusing on Todd, and maybe even get to see a little bit of his past through flashbacks, his ending would have felt a little bit more earned. Don't get me wrong, I love Todd and his conclusion works great, but I just feel like they didn't have the time to dive deep. I actually do think Mr. Peanut Butter is handled fairly well, and Princess Carolyn has a very satisfying conclusion, but they felt a little rushed as well. BoJack and Diane are handled perfectly in my opinion, and that's why I give them props under the circumstances. It was a good call offering the perfect finale for these two, rather than giving all five of them a balanced ending, none of which would have lived up to what we got with these two. The final 8 episodes of BoJack are outstanding. It's about the fall of BoJack. Every horrible thing that we, the audience, know he did is now public knowledge with the exception of Gina. She did seem to get her wish. The first half of the season shows a version of him that is actually willing to change and be a better person, the more ideal version of BoJack. The second half of the season shows him throw all of that away when he loses his award for being a decent person, which is his relationship with his half-sister and his job as a college professor, a career that he enjoyed significantly more than his Hollywood career. He believes that he should not be punished for stuff he did pre-rehab and immediately turns back to seasons 1-5 BoJack, but like, actually a little worse?
No, they can't get me on old shit. I'm a different person now.
BoJack is exposed, but he gives a really good interview that gets him off the hook for pretty much everything. He's actually seen as a hero. He doesn't deserve this fate, but he got super lucky and successfully got away with every horrible thing he's done. He then enjoys the attention and does another interview pretty much gloating about the shit that used to make him feel so guilty over the course of the show. Sarah Lynn's death becomes joke material for him.
Speaking of addicts, I think you're addicted to Sarah Lynn.
For the viewers that actually sympathized with him, this is a huge slap in the face. When he gets called out and is no longer in control of the situation, he becomes more pathetic than we've ever seen him. He tries to justify every shitty thing he's ever done. He immediately throws Sharona, someone who he just made amends with during the first half of the season, under the bus for no reason. A heartwarming moment now just comes off as bitter when revisiting it. It isn't until there is absolutely no way he can defend his actions that he is honest, and we get a reaction from Diane that says so much about the character and the show.
I also want to thank the Retake animation team back here in LA, who we've regularly asked to illustrate complex emotional moments, such as this actual stage direction. Diane stares straight ahead at the TV, her expression a mix of pity and recognition and sadness and acceptance and disappointment and anger and pride. And they nailed it!
Let's talk about Diane for a bit. One of my favorite scenes from the entire season is when BoJack goes to speak to his students when him, Princess Carolyn, and Diane are trying to work out this horrible situation. You just have him talk to the students and you can see Diane and Princess Carolyn reacting from the other room. They are both amused by BoJack's charm and miserable from what they just learned about him. In the second to last episode, Herb refers to BoJack as a talented charmer and a
stupid piece of shit.
They both want to like this guy. We, the audience, want to like this guy, and that's what makes this final stretch so difficult. He was given every chance to change, and he didn't take it, or did for a little bit, and then self-sabotaged himself. Everyone has a character of the main five that they relate to the most, but Diane shares a similar perspective on BoJack that we, the audience, do. The audience and Diane meet BoJack at the same time. The audience and Diane learn about BoJack's past and what shaped him into the person he is at the same time. The audience and Diane also know that it can't be used as an excuse for shitty behavior that ruins lives. Diane's expression near the end of the interview episode perfectly sums up how a majority of the audience feels about him. We can like him, but we can't just ignore what he did. Or can we? The following episode, The Horny Unicorn, does a great job of showing us the different opinions on BoJack now that all this information is out. A majority of it is discussed, but there is still a variety. We all have the same view of BoJack's life that Diane does, which is why she is the perfect embodiment of the audience. But more often than not, the audience doesn't share the same opinions of Diane. Some of the people in the audience flat out despise Diane. Some people think that since the interviewer did it for her own gain, she is in the wrong and BoJack doesn't deserve the backlash. And that is true, she was acting out of self-interest. They show a scene that confirms this, but to this person, that makes what BoJack did okay. Just from reading the comments, a lot of fans came to BoJack's defense, and I think that the same thing happens when a celebrity that someone likes a lot is called out. Hell, they actually covered this in the show's second season with Hank Hippopopoulos. I literally read comments that said fuck Hollyhock and called her selfish for the preceding events. This guy defending BoJack at the party is an accurate reaction. It's not the most common reaction, but it does exist. There are also people who despise BoJack now and can't keep it to themselves. They don't have all the context that we do. But calling BoJack Horseman out is just the popular thing to do right now. This to me is a more reasonable approach of the two, considering how high the stakes are with what BoJack did. And I do know there are people who love this show but really can't stand BoJack.
How could you like horsing around but not like the horse? That's like watching Castle but hating castles. I mean, I've never seen it. I assume it's about castles.
But for me personally, I do connect with Diane and Princess Carolyn's reactions the most. I'm disgusted with him, but I wish I didn't have to be. We've seen him show kindness to the woman who played a large role in making him who he is, but we've seen him be an even worse parent figure to Sarah Lynn. We've seen him agree to do a TV show just to help a friend out, and we've seen him constantly take advantage of that friend. A talented charmer and a stupid piece of shit. I can't even really blame the fans who think the point is that he's shitty and there's no saving him. I think the show is a little more optimistic than that, but it is certainly not suggesting that because of the circumstances of his upbringing, BoJack isn't in the wrong. At the end of the day, as awful as she is, Angela was entirely right.
Grow up! You'd play these games if I hadn't done this, if I wasn't so that. But you did, and you were, and here we are. Here we are.
Alright, let's talk about Hollyhock. This episode ends in a way that disappoints a lot of fans of the show, and I'm about to defend it, but I will give some credit to the criticism for one reason. Every season, there's a character that comes into BoJack's life. 4 out of 6 times, they leave his life due to who he is. Diane and Hollyhock are the only two that stuck around. So Hollyhock starts to feel like part of the cast. Not as big as the main five, but still a main character, and there's no warning at all that her final scene is the last time we will see her. She does not get closure like Diane does, and as a fan, that can be frustrating. I, however, disagree with this criticism. I just don't think it's unreasonable to criticize. I'm not the first person to state this, but she is removed from the audience as she is removed from BoJack's life. This is a devastating consequence of his actions. To really make us feel the weight of it, we can't ever see her again.
You are never seeing Hollyhock again.
That's dead. Over. A thing that happens no longer, like a whimper in the wind.
What was in the letter was irrelevant, and the conclusion goes without saying. She wants nothing to do with him anymore. Hollyhock is not a main character on the show, but a main part of BoJack's character that he has to say goodbye to. Vance Wagner depends on his daughter for his happiness, and as a result, they are both miserable with each other's company. BoJack depends on Hollyhock for his happiness, but she isn't going to fall into the same toxic cycle. She hasn't known BoJack that long, and she can get out of it. It sucks, it hurts, but it makes sense. Also, interpret the show however you want, but I don't think I've ever disagreed with a theory more than the suicide letter theory. BoJack doesn't just throw suicide around like that. This isn't 13 Reasons Why. How could the same show, no, the same season of a show, write a character like that and have the view from halfway down scene at the same time? Why on earth would she kill herself over BoJack's actions? She doesn't live for BoJack. Her connection to BoJack was good for BoJack. It was not good for her. Anyways, we're on the final three episodes now, and each of them kind of do their own thing. BoJack is pushed to the side for the first one, as the focus mainly goes to the other four characters getting a proper conclusion. The second to last episode is all about BoJack and the people who have died over the course of the show, and the final one is about his relationship with the other four main characters. So the third to last episode, Angela, offers us something that the finale doesn't: closure. Mr. Peanut Butter has learned to live on his own and not make his relationships more about himself. He also has one last conversation with Diane, and it really gives the two a lot of closure and really brings everything with them throughout the show full circle. Character arc complete. Diane has finally found a way to be happy and is now moving to Texas to be with her new boyfriend. Character arc complete. Todd is living on his own in a happy relationship, has a job that he enjoys and is good at, and finally made amends with his parents. Character arc complete. Princess Carolyn finally has a good balance between her personal life and her work life, and found someone she is very compatible with. With Judah and Ruth D, she finally has the family she always wanted. Character arc completed. And then, BoJack relapses. The Margo Martindale story arc kind of pokes fun at the idea of everything coming to a nice and well-organized conclusion, where every bad thing that happened had meaning, and she is completely off the hook. She arguably did worse things than BoJack ever did, but her tone was very different from any of the other characters in the show, so we don't mind her getting off scotch-free, whether it makes sense or not. This is the ending that BoJack wanted for himself, and this scene depicts how silly of an ending that would be, for BoJack to just be off the hook. The View from Halfway Down is one of the best episodes of the show, if not the best. I'm a little on the fence, it's a little too new to say for sure, but I rewatched this one so many times. There are so many clever reincorporations in this episode. Of course, there's the obvious ones, like the meals that each character eats resembles their death or some other aspect of their life, and all the acts have something to do with the kind of performance or art they did in their lives. BoJack's dad being a writer and reading a poem, and her being a comedian and being the host, for example. But then there are some very minor ones that were foreshadowed earlier this season, like Diane saying don't wait for the other shoe to fall off when referring to BoJack not wanting to be completely honest in the upcoming interview, and then the bird losing a single shoe when jumping out of a window. It is also no coincidence that Ruthie ripped off a certain part of a certain Peyton. I read an interesting comment suggesting that the reason Zach Braff doesn't get a final meal and is the waiter is because in the episode where he died, he's burned to death and then everyone goes cannibalistic and feasts on him. So he died serving people. Possibly a stretch, but I would not be surprised if that was supposed to be the point. I actually kind of hope that was supposed to be the point. I fucking love Zach Braff in this episode, by the way. We like to meme on poor old Zach Braff, but he successfully provided comedy in one of the most stressful episodes of anything I've ever seen, and it was greatly appreciated.
Whoa, no, please! I'm not ready! I never got to direct my Backdraft remake, Zach Braff's Backdraft. I never finished my memoir. I started a Zach which started the whole world braffing. I never got to license the Zach Braff short stack breakfast attack at Shake Shack. Cash strap hash brown fans who hashtag Zach Snacks get cash back fast with the Braff Bucks.
It's an incredible episode, and so much has already been said about it that I don't want to repeat, which is why I'm mainly only talking about observations rather than describing the meaning behind the episode. What I get out of this episode more than anything is that BoJack realizes he does not want to die. Him realizing that gives you a little bit of hope that he will finally do better, no longer treating his own morality so recklessly. But there are reasons to believe this and doubt this in the finale. I do love how well the episode is able to incorporate a dream feel to it. Them trying to get the bird out of the house is a screaming metaphor of something, but I honestly don't care too much about what the bird means. All of these characters we know over the course of the show trying to get a bird out of the house about anything about the scenario seems strange to them at all. This is a scenario that doesn't even really make sense in the BoJack universe, only our own universe. It's just a really weird scene that nobody questions, and that to me is a pretty accurate depiction of dreams. I love how BoJack is speaking with Sarah Lynn for what could be hours, and then only before her performance remembers the horrible shit he did to her and tries to apologize. We forget pretty major details of our lives when we dream. Sometimes we see someone who's passed away, and it isn't until later in the dream that we remember it happened. BoJack is talking to Herb and Sarah Lynn so guiltless in this dream. His dad appears as secretariat to the dinner, and this doesn't strike him as odd at all. I really think they nailed the dream aesthetic of this episode, and out of all the second-to-last dread-seeking episodes of the show, it's probably my favorite one. Each of the characters' performance reflects their life and death. Sarah Lynn is a musician who started off innocent and was ruined by Hollywood as she grew up, turning into the person she was before she died. In the end, she jumped through the door herself, but her life could have been something very different without the horrible influence she had her entire life. The line, "A song you taught me when I was small," shows how relevant even the earliest episodes of the show are on the ending.
The most important thing is you gotta give the people what they want. Even if it kills you, even if it empties you out until there's nothing left to empty. No matter what happens, no matter how much it hurts, you don't stop dancing, and you don't stop smiling, and you give those people what they want.
An interesting fact that someone pointed out to me is that the song Don't Stop Dancing has only been sung in BoJack's head, and he's the one who said the very same thing to Sarah Lynn when she was a child. This is very much his viewpoint of the world. Though in the final episode, he can very clearly see the flaws of that mindset. Beatrice does a dance while her brother assists. Beatrice would perform dances at old dinner parties, as mentioned many times throughout the show, and Cracker Jack lived to serve. Them playing I Will Always Think of You Again adds a really haunting vibe to the scene. Before pulling off an impressive stunt, she whispers to BoJack, "This is the hard part," and then she jumps up doing multiple spins in the air. She then says to herself, "And now the easy part," as she is surrounded by ribbons and disappears. This might be obvious, but I feel when she says this is the hard part, she's referring to life, and the easy part refers to death. As cold of a person she was, Beatrice was never one to take the easy way out, and she is the only one we don't see go through the door. She leaves this world completely naturally, and not early like all the other characters did. Before Herb leaves, he welcomes BoJack to the stage, referencing something from each season of the show.
The star of Horsin' Around and the BoJack Horseman Show, Filbert, Secretariat, the upcoming horny unicorn, and a stupid piece of shit.
The ending of this episode leaves a sinking feeling in your stomach that would not have worked in any other season, but since it was the last season, BoJack dying was a real possibility. I kind of doubted it would happen just because I think it contradicts the hopeful nature of the show, but as far as fakeouts go, this is one of the better ones. This shit normally pisses me off, but BoJack did it really well with meaning. BoJack's near-death experience offers him a new perspective. It's another push in the right direction, but it's hard to say that he will really change. We don't get to know that, but if the show would have killed BoJack off, I don't think I would have liked that ending either, even though it would have been a more interesting ending. It may have been more of a jaw-dropper the first time I watched the final episodes, but I feel like it would hurt rewatches. When you see the old man tell BoJack it gets a little easier every day, but you have to do it every day, you would be thinking about his death. When you see BoJack stare off into the distance at the wild horses running, giving him a glimpse of hope after nearly ending everything, you would just see it as a delay. A lot of people say that the end of a season 4 is now the most depressing ending to any season, and to some extent I agree, but a counter-argument is that he could feel this again someday. I doubt he'll reconnect with Hollyhock, but he had a falling out with Herb and lost Sarah Lynn before he even met Hollyhock, and he probably felt a similar dread when he lost those two. He can find this level of happiness again, but he can't choose to solely rely on that person if it ever happens again. That's what he did to Diane, and it destroys their friendship. Diane said it from the very start, we have to be responsible for our own happiness. Maybe these two could have still been friends if it weren't for that phone call. Even with the whole world hating BoJack, maybe there's a chance for this friendship to exist. But all BoJack proved in these final episodes is that no matter how much change he does go through, he is always willing to go back and hurt Diane again, whether he means to or not. In the final episode, Peanut Butter, Todd, and Princess Carolyn all seem like they're okay with BoJack being in their lives. Peanut Butter's opinion on BoJack hasn't even changed. Todd isn't going to be his roommate ever again, but he's still willing to talk to him and be a friend to him. He even says he's happy to see him. He just might be a little bit more of a distant friend now. And Princess Carolyn still clearly cares about BoJack a lot, but she isn't going to have a professional relationship with him anymore. They are friends, and they will never go any further than that again. So with that being said, there is a chance for him. There are people in this world that care about him, and he can perhaps find the happiness he had with Hollyhock again. But this time, he really needs to understand his actions can have consequences, even if they happened a long time ago. and he can't rely on one person as his sole supply of happiness. I feel like the scene with him and Princess Carolyn offers two different paths, one which could lead to a happy ending and one that could lead to an ending worse than anything we've seen. The happy ending is going back to the prison to volunteer. He said he enjoyed teaching and these are the kind of people he should be helping. You know, some of them are in there for crimes worse than he committed. I mean, fuck, the cartel guy from the first episode is there. But there are people in prison who fucked up but could still do more good for the world than bad once they are out. BoJack helping these kind of people could help him be better too. The other path is getting back into the entertainment industry, an industry that played a major role in the person he's been and has only hurt himself and the people around him. It brings out the worst in BoJack, and this isn't the first second chance. It will likely go really poorly for him if this is the path he goes down. Princess Carolyn recognizes this and feels bad for even mentioning that Hollywood has forgiven him, and refuses to work with him. The show doesn't give us closure on him because there's really no point in doing so. Saying that he won't get into any more trouble sounds dishonest. Saying that he's going to get himself killed is too miserable. They really can't do either and deliver a satisfying conclusion. But going down the middle does feel a little anticlimactic, doesn't it? Well, what the hell then? If we don't know what's going to happen to this guy, what the hell was the point of the show? Well, do you remember what I said earlier? About how we, the audience, share the same perspective as Diane, and how the show begins with Diane meeting BoJack? I think a lot of us didn't even realize what the show was about. The ending of BoJack isn't about whether he's going to change or not. It's about how the world changed around him, the people he knew and their experiences, and how they grew because of him, both for better and for worse. And I'm sure that in the 6 years of the show, we, the audience, who've been watching it from the very beginning, have also changed. Diane says her final goodbyes at the same time we, the audience, have to say our goodbyes. I'm not saying the show's about us, but I am saying it's about growth. And I think a lot of us are able to connect with this ending because of that. Maybe BoJack is a lost cause. Maybe he can turn himself around. The Diane who sits with him on the roof at the end of the show is not the same Diane who sits with him at the start of the show. She found a way to be happy. But without her own self-reflection, often influenced by BoJack's actions, both good and bad, she may not have grown into the same person she is today. And that is when we get one of the most meaningful lines in the entire series.
I think there are people that help you become the person that you end up being, and you can be grateful for them, even if they were never meant to be in your life forever. I'm glad I knew you too.
Diane has grown enough to know that she does need a different lifestyle in order to be happy, and that does come with sacrifice and a few things. BoJack has grown enough to not rely on someone else for his own happiness. He understands and accepts why people in his life are leaving. It doesn't mean he will change, but I do feel like he's gotten the message. The show ends with the song Mr. Blue, with lyrics so relevant to the show, you can almost imagine Diane singing the song to BoJack.
Mr. Blue, I have to go now, darling, don't be angry. Know that you're tired, know that you're sore and sick and sad for some reason. So I'll leave you with a smile, kiss you on the cheek, and you will call it treason.
As the two stare up at the sky, there's a small detail that really offers us the conclusion of their characters. They both briefly look at each other as if they want to say something else, but neither of them really have anything left to say, and both of them have enough self-awareness to not ruin what is a bitter but also sweet moment. This show really embraces the sitcom style of humor, and a lot of sentimental or serious moments are ruined by BoJack. This is a moment that BoJack doesn't ruin, and the decision that both of them make to not say another word is what ends the show.